Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. You're here with your brother Muhammad Tawheed from Guidance Avenue here at Speaker's Corner. It's been an amazingly interesting first couple of hours here at the corner, and we'll have a little chat about that. Why? We actually had the shahada from this gentleman's brother just a minute ago. I'm going to introduce you. The gentleman's going to introduce himself to you now.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name's Isa. I come from Leeds and I'm reverted to Islam 1 year, 7 months ago.
Alhamdulillah. And what is it about today that's actually turned out as a special moment for both of us?
The special occasion today is that my brother took his shahada and become Muslim, and now we're going to move on and
get into the nitty-gritty, yeah?
Get into the nitty-gritty, as you just said, yeah.
Inshallah. So basically, Isa's a gentleman, and I spoke to his brother earlier. They both come from Leeds, as he said. They've come yesterday. I've had a chat with Isa, and he's got an amazingly interesting story to tell. Yeah, and you would notice by the name of this video. So I leave it to Isa, inshallah, and we can actually go into what it is that brought him towards Islam, and starting a bit about his past, where he grew up, his roots, and see what it was that actually channeled him to come from kufr to iman, from disbelief to belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah. So Isa, I leave you to it, my brother. Just a bit about your past, where you grew up, about you know, your upbringing.
Yeah, well, I grew up in a council estate. We grew up on the messing about on streets, hanging about with people, and doing stupid things as you do. I also went to a place called Boys Brigade, which is a Christian organisation, you know. So I knew a bit about the Bible already. But as I went to the church, I never believed in that Jesus was the Son of God or any of that. I always believed in a Creator. So as I was growing up, yeah, I stopped going to the church. When I was 17 years old or something like that, and I started drinking alcohol and taking substances and stuff like that, which led me away from getting away. I also played football, rugby. I'm a big sports fan, by the way, and which led me down to drinking and drinking more, and then it led me to a place called a right wing group called the EDL. And as I was drinking, you become a sheep, so to speak, because you follow the next man, what the next man's doing. So I had a few friends that were following EDL, and they was talking about Islam.
How old were you at this point?
Maybe, so I'm 28 now, so about, just when they first started, I was about 21, 22, you know, it all started off like humble and stuff like that, but then it got extreme. But when you've got friends at Saudi are telling you that, oh yeah, Islam's this, Islam's that, Islam's that. As a person, I was never a reader, so I didn't like reading. So I never, I didn't even know what the Quran was, to be honest with you. Right. When I went to go like into the right wing and go to EDL, I never went there with knowing what Islam was. I just thought they were building these temples in our country. Yeah, and they were killing us. That's all I thought.
The Muslimic law.
Yeah, the Muslimic law, the Shakira law. Yeah, so
So your first views of Islam were obviously negative, yeah?
Yeah, my first views of Islam is beyond what actually Islam is, yeah. It's crazy.
And at this age now, so you've just come into this organisation, EDL. now you've got your sense of brotherhood amongst these British individuals.
I think that's another thing as well. You at the time, when you first join, it's like an honeymoon period. So in EDL, everyone's embracing you and stuff right. Like that. So when they embrace you, you think, you know, you're good to yourself, I've got friends. Mm. But when it comes, you know, it was all about the alcohol. But what happens with alcohol is in the morning you have a hangover. Right. No one gets in touch with you to see how you are. So you become more lonely in a sense, right, till you meet them again at the pub. So I just classed them as pub mates after a while, because I only seen them in the pub. Right. Nobody wanted to do anything else apart from the pub. And the thing that fingered with EDL is me and my friends, we always liked it because of the alcohol afterwards and stuff. It was, you know, and to say, like, I don't think anybody knew anything about Islam. No one ever read the Quran. I never heard anyone speak about Islam. I heard them speak about Islam and just, oh, they're building temples, we'll just go, you know, it's a let's get drunk, so to speak. So
now amongst the EDL conversations, what kind of conversations would they have pertaining to Islam when they actually spoke about Islam and the Muslims?
They weren't much. Yeah. It was more boy banter. So basically, the guys that I hung about with at the time probably weren't as extreme as the likes of Tommy Robinson and the likes of the guys at that time, which right. I went on a few matches and where Tommy Robinson was, but I met him once or twice. But I didn't see like now Tommy's coming out and he's being a bit, he's, you know, I didn't see him in that light, so I only seen another side to him. So, yeah. You know, there's different sides to people, and if when you want to portray A towards a certain people, you change.
Yeah.
So you go from this humble guy to
yes. And so you know this area that you grew up in as well in Leeds. Would you say that this area has predominantly a lot of EDL members there, or did it at the time?
No, it comes from all over. I come from to be honest, my school was 60% Muslim, but the problem is at the time we was fighting against each other, so nobody taught me anything about Islam, and so no one taught me about Islam in school. So
and how, after you'd now joined EDL at this age and you've gone back into school and you've seen in your community you've got all of the Muslims around you, how did it make you feel around them now at this point?
I don't know. I had a sense of guilt, because at the end of the day, yeah, is that they're going to look at me as if I was going in there to kill them, to do whatever I want. I only went there for
a terrorist.
Yeah. I only went in there. If you look at it my way, I just thought Muslims were terrorists. And that's what I got drilled into my head. But I wasn't willing to go and educate myself. And I went and educated myself, and I took my shahada. So that's the...
I do actually want to get up to that. What I would like to know is, where was it at your point that you went from the honeymoon period? When did that actually die down, after the honeymoon period of the EDL, when all of the bazaars and the novelty just wore off?
EDL disappeared, and I joined the Britons First.
Right, okay, so you're... all right, so now we've got the name of this video, EDL, Britain First to Muslim. All right, cool. So Britain First, fight back. Yeah.
So right. when Paul Golding started talking about things, I agreed with him.
Right.
But it come to a point where it were too much for me, and many people in my family, my friends, even some of my friends were saying, "Look, you're not. We weren't brought up to be racist. You weren't brought up to be." Brought up to be like this, so come away from it. And
right.
And even my mother spoke to me about it as well. So
what did your mum say to you, and what kind of impact did it have on you?
She said, "I didn't bring you up to be racist. I didn't bring you up to against. I always brought you up with respect and love for anybody." And it kind of took me away. And at the time, I was in a bad place. I was drinking and stuff. And I actually sat back and thought, if my mum's saying that, then I must be doing something wrong. And there's, you know, at the time it was just, and I just remember clicking the dislike on the page and never looking back. It was so, but it was like, that was like about 5-6 months before I took my shot. Before I started looking into Islam.
Right. So you know, at the point that you actually went from, all right, so you had the honeymoon period, obviously, as you refer to it, you know, with EDR and with Britain First and whatever, and then those died down. At what point did you go from thinking, do you know what, I have to drop these organisations out of my life?
I remember thinking, where is actually the people that I actually started with? Because when there was quite a few people.
Some newbies that started on with you.
But you know, it's like they did it for their own agenda. What they did, they bring you in, show you a bit of love, and then next new person come in. You know, that's how it works.
And recruitment centre.
Yeah. Yeah. Agency.
An agency, yeah.
Yeah, right, yeah. Yeah. We'll give him 40 hours first week, and then 20 hours next week, and then
in the deep end.
Yeah, in the deep end.
Right, so what was it then that you actually thought, do you know what? Where were you? What were you doing on that day where you just thought, do you know what? I have to release myself from this whole EDL and Britain First.
I was in two minds. I was thinking, well, what are we actually achieving by going on these marches? What are we actually doing? You know, there's one thing I've always thought, yeah, there's 1.6 billion Muslims on this planet. If 1.6 billion Muslims was crazy and lunatic,
yeah,
we'd be all, we'd get, there'd be slaughters on the street everywhere we go.
Yeah.
So I have to think, well, I grew up with Muslims. They didn't try to kill me. Yeah. They didn't try to eat me. They didn't, you know, they always shared stuff with me. Yeah. I lived on the same estate. I lived in an estate where Pakistani Muslims, Muslim. Yeah. Only thing they didn't teach me was Islam. They taught me everything else, you know, about, and I never understood when they used to bring samosas round about Ramadan and stuff like that. So, but that's when I turned around and actually looked at my past life and thought, well, you know what, I've grew up with Muslims, what am I doing? Why am I like this? What's led me down this road? And I blame alcohol and being a sheep as well. I was a sheep, you know.
Yeah. So, I mean, when you gradually came out of it, would you say that, was it something in your heart that changed on a split second after that you just thought, do you know what? Now that I know that this isn't the truth, when did you start searching for truth? How did it stumble upon you? When would you say that the first seed was planted in your heart towards coming towards Islam?
In 2014, I was in a bad car crash and I broke my leg, and I was in bed for many months. And at that time, I was thinking about stuff at that time, and I had a few, I had loads of time on my hands. I watched a few videos and that about, because I was trying to get back into Christianity, because I was brought up Christian. So I wanted a bit of faith back in my life, and I just couldn't come to the conclusion and the logic of why people were teaching me different in the church, but the Bible were teaching me different. And as you read the Bible, it teaches you the true way of many true ways of Jesus, salam. And then I went back when I got walking again. I took advantage of walking again and I started drinking again. And I started taking advantage, whereas I thought I need to get away from all this drink.
Yeah.
And so I started drinking, and I got depressed because I played football 4 times a week. I was ready, and it got me really down. I put loads of weight on, and I just went into like a suicidal thing, and I started drinking, taking more substances, and I started hanging about that with another guy who's still my friend now, and we were drinking together. But at that time, when I got away from EDL, I remember thinking, and Britain's First, I was thinking about 2 weeks, 3 weeks. As it goes on, I was just thinking, wow, why did I even join that? Why was I a sheep? Because my friends know me as a person who's not a sheep. I don't really follow things. You know, I go with my heart, and I always did. And that part of my life, I don't know where I went. I just went on a different... I got led down that road.
So you went on that bender once you came out of, come out of that bender hospital. Yeah. When was it that you come out of that bender exactly?
I was still going through the bender when I was looking into Islam.
Right, okay.
But what it was, I stumbled up on a year before I took my shahada, stumbled up on a video about Jesus, Islam.
So this was the first time now that you've experience. Would you say that this is the seed now? This is where the seed was planted?
This is where I started to understand Islam.
Yeah, please tell us about it.
Well, I was just on Facebook one day, and I seen this video, and it was called, the YouTube channel was called, I'm allowed to say the YouTube channel, Merciful Servant.
Yeah, sure.
Merciful Servant. I don't like Merciful Servant, I don't know what it is. So I watched this video about Jesus, Islam, and I'm like, wow, that's the Jesus I believe in. What is this? And I watched every video on there in 2 months. And I mean, even my mum was saying to me, what are you doing? You're not going out of house.
So what was it about Jesus that you saw in this video that you believed in?
That he didn't get crucified, and he was all sorts. There was loads. Yeah. Everything. He wasn't the son of God. He was a prophet.
Yeah.
The messenger of God. He just took me away. And I was like, I was just like in sort of a zone. Even though I was still drinking, I was still doing what I was doing. I felt different, and I felt like, wow, this is summer. But I watched every video on Merciful Servant. If you look at, I can look on my phone and it says watch. And even my mum, my family was like coming in my room and saying, whoa, what are you doing? You know. And for 2 months I watched every single, and I didn't know what it was. I didn't know it was Islam. So I watched all the stories about the Prophet Muhammad.
And what did you, what struck you about the Prophet Muhammad when you were speaking, when you were learning up on him?
Oh, just his the way of his life. It was, well, at the time, it was, I was watching that many videos. I didn't know what it was. So I was in a taxi one day coming home from my friend's house, and it was a Pakistani brother. And I said to him, what religion believes that Jesus was a prophet of God? And he said, my religion. So I said, what's your religion, brother? And he went, Islam. And I went, no, you're terrorists. And he put his hand on my shoulder.
He's a part-time terrorist, part-time minicab driver.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, that's, you know, this is how, you know, stupid I've become, yeah. And I put my, he put his hand on my shoulder and he smiled at me like,
happy terrorist.
Wow. He took me away. So I just said, he just said to me, keep watching them videos, brother. Just keep watching them. So for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, I come away from it. I said, I'll never be a Muslim. No way. These are terrorists, bro. That's what I said to myself. And I was just telling myself, no, no. And one day I was on the bus coming home. I was just having one of my down days. And I thought to myself, I need to watch these videos, man. There's something in these videos that's making me keep going. And I carried on watching the videos, and then I started working at a place called Broadway in Bradford, and I met a brother called Bashir, and he what's it called? There's a few.
So this Bashir was the first Muslim brother that now you've actually met and become acquainted with?
The thing is with me, I've always been a person who don't tell anybody stuff. So I never told him that I was looking into Islam. It was this is the thing that this is
observation.
This is the guidance I got, and what it was is that Bashir came into my life at a time when I was very suicidal, and very just didn't want to speak to anybody. So I started working with him, and I didn't know he was Muslim. He didn't have this big beard, like you are. What defines a Muslim in EDL's eyes is a big beard, yeah. Big four. No, he didn't have none of this. So we was working together. We never spoke about religion or anything. But we got on really well. And then he took my number. He just asked for my number, took my number. And 2 weeks later, I was having a really bad day. And then he rang me up and said, do you want to come for some food? So I wasn't going to go because I was in that mode. But I went. And he was speaking about Islam. And, I never said that I was looking into it. So he was teaching me from his point of view. And I was getting taught from what I was watching on YouTube. And it was all connecting. So, and it was making sense to me, it was like, I was like, wow. But the only thing that was stopping me taking my shahada was, I was still trying to please other people, what will other people think of me? What will other people, get rid of me? And all
so
that
by, went... So me. Now, by this time, you'd already accepted Islam?
At that time, I already accepted that there was one God and that Prophet Muhammad was the last messenger. And we carried on working, and me and Bashir, and we carried on talking, and... Just one day I was...
What kind of questions would you say that you had, Isa, pertaining to Islam at that part of your life?
My main question was why do Muslims kill people and stuff like that?
And what kind of answers were you given?
I got given every answer that I needed at the time. And that comes to me, shahada, man. That's why I took my shahada. I took my shahada because I believe, but at the time I had my doubts and...
So what kind of answers did you come across to that question?
After that, I was still, on the bad path, drinking, yeah. And it was bonfire night 2015, and I was drinking, eating pork pies, and doing with my friends, and the day after was the sixth, and the day is I woke up and I thought I need to take my shahada, I'm ready. I need to...
Just like that. Woke up and...
I woke up and I rang Bashir. And I said, Bashir, brother, will you take me to the mosque? I need to become Muslim. And
Allahu Akbar.
He started laughing. And what are you laughing at? And he went, please study it first and see, And I said, I've been studying it for the last 10 months, bro. And he started laughing and he's like, what? And you haven't told me? Because I didn't tell anyone. Because I didn't want that side or that side's influence. I was very paranoid. And he took me to the mosque and I was watching Jummah.
So you went to the masjid, it was a Friday, yeah. And they were praying.
Yeah, it was Jummah, it was just like...
So you listened to the Friday sermon?
Yeah, I listened to the Friday Kupa, yeah, and then...
Was it in English?
Yeah, it was in English.
What was it about? If you can remember, if
no,
not.
I was too overwhelmed with people coming out of their house and coming to pray. And,
And how did it feel like? So now you've walked into this masjid, you've seen this Friday prayer, so now you've gone in. What did Islam look like to you inside this masjid now?
Peaceful. Peaceful, and I didn't have no one. And since I've become Muslim, and I've never heard anyone bad mouth or slander, because I come from a background where people are always talking about people, always talking bad about people, always slandering people, always hating on people. So when I went in there and I seen this, and people was and I was like, well, this is not the Islam I got taught. This is definitely not the Islam. And so I was sat there at the back and I was thinking to myself, what? People actually come from the homes, from work, to put the face in front of the floor for the Creator. It was just amazing. But I didn't take my shahada at that point because I had a few questions. And Imam Masood said, oh, well, we can go in the office and we'll talk. And Masood, may Allah bless him, he answered every single question, and he said, "Are you ready?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm more than ready. You've answered every question." Because when I was going to the church and asking questions about the Trinity and about stuff like that, it was believe in Jesus. They were just knocking me off to Jesus.
So now at that point, then you took your Shahada there and then.
Yeah.
What kind of feeling did you feel as soon as you took your Shahada?
I was very overwhelmed. I was very overwhelmed. I've never had that like unity of people. I've never hugged so many men in my life.
So, I mean, it was kind of like what your brother just experienced just now, because he just took a Shahada. And for everyone watching, you're going to see that video is going to be in the description box down below. So you can take a look at brother Dale's Shahada. He may have changed his name by now that you're watching the video. If he does, I'll update you guys. So, yeah, so you've taken your Shahada at this point.
Yeah, I took my Shahada then.
How did you feel? So, obviously, you had a feeling of overwhelming feeling.
Overwhelming, and my Shahada video went viral on Facebook.
Oh, right. Okay.
So, I had over 1,000 inboxes to deal with. So, it was very overwhelming. I had some hate and some love. A lot of it from the Make Me Past, you know.
So you went from ex-EDO, ex-Britain First lad in Leeds / Bradford to a Muslim celebrity.
Well, yeah, I go places now and people are always, they're always
kind. Yeah,
please,
tell us, what kind of work is it that you're getting into now in terms of, I mean, on Facebook you were saying that you've got a page, and what do you deal with on your page?
Just deal with showing people real Islam and what people are actually like, and, you know, getting pictures with people around the community and showing them that we do charity work and stuff, because I don't think our stuff goes viral enough, and there's people in Pakistan who love watching us and seeing what England's like, all over the globe, and I'm not, you know, some of the brothers have messaged me saying, you're doing it to be famous. I'm not doing it to be famous. I'm not doing any of this to be famous. I'm doing it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Showing everyone the Islam and guide them to what I have. Islam saved me, you know what I mean? It saved me from the dark. It brought me to the light. Yeah. And that's all I'm trying to do, is show people that, you know, we're not here to hurt anybody. And just show people that you are brainwashed into thinking, because I was brainwashed into thinking that Muslims are terrorists. And actually, I've seen a lot of good reception of people, and a lot of, you know, there's more good than there's bad.
Have you bumped into any of your ex-EDL or Britain First members since you became a Muslim?
That's a good question. Yeah, I have.
What happened?
There was like, oh, we're happy for you and stuff like that, and then one of my friends told me that they were slagging me off when I was gone, so. You know, it was always going to be. But to my face, no one's come up to my face directly and said anything bad about me. Or,
I mean, Allah guides whom he pleases and misguides whom he pleases.
Yeah, you're right, inshallah.
So, I mean, for the future of the people who are interested in maybe learning a bit about Islam, or even possibly just learning about if there is a creator or not, or even if they're just in a state of their life like you were, where you were feeling really in the lows and depressed, you know, down in the dumps, so to speak, what kind of advice would you feel is necessary for them to hear right now?
My advice is educate yourself, honestly. Educate, read a book, because if you don't read a book, you're always going to be in this delusion. And then come and question people. If you read the Quran and then question people, then the people can't say, look, that's the thing I was doing. You know, I was one of them people who would talk about a book I've never read. Right. And I didn't like reading at the time. Now I have read the Quran, and yeah, it's one of them. You know, if you believe and something's stopping you, you know, just open your eye. You've got to be open minded as well, because, you know, it's really good to educate yourself. Because me, I've come from an uneducated background. I've not got no education. Now I feel like I'm a lot more.
But you have the best knowledge that will never leave you, inshallah, and that's the knowledge of Tawheed. And ascribing no partners in worship to Allah alone.
Yeah, the another thing that is the best thing I've ever done is stop drinking. You know.
Would you say that this was a direct result of you becoming a Muslim? These positive changes in your life?
This is, I was speaking to a brother last week, and he was saying to me, why did you become Muslim? And the reason I become Muslim is because of there's five things that brought me another to Islam. I mean, in context of why it appealed to me, was no drinking, no drugs, no gambling, no sleeping with women, and no interest. All that there just appeased to my life, because it was that there is, if you go gambling, you spend all your money, go to pubs, spend all your money, you need to get a loan. It's a big, massive vicious circle. And it was a big, vicious circle, and I got myself in a lot of trouble with gambling and, well, not so much drinking, and it's the best thing I've ever done. And since I've stopped eating pork, alhamdulillah, I've not had heartburn ever since. And I was telling my mum last week, since I've stopped eating pork, I used to get really bad heartburn. I was on Lansoprazole tablets and stuff like that, and now I'm off them since I've stopped eating pork. So alhamdulillah to the guidance of the Quran and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best guidance I've ever had. You know, it's got me away. And many people, I've spoke to many people, and they're like, wow, you've changed now. You're a better person. I'm more caring. I didn't have no care before. I didn't care about anybody. I didn't care about anything. So basically, just keep strong, keep firm, man. Ramadan Mubarak.
Ramadan Kareem from us here at Guidance Avenue. So we've had an amazing talk with our brother Isa. May Allah bless him and protect him and preserve him and bring those to Islam through him. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala facilitate through him and through me and through all of you, inshallah. Stay tuned. You can click on the description link to see the live the shahada that was taken with myself. Isa was witness to it as well, of his brother here at Speaker's Corner. Please comment, like, and subscribe the page. Also, you're going to have the details of Isa's Facebook page. You're going to find that in the description box as well. If and when you want to contact myself, you can contact me via my Facebook page, also there as well, and guidanceavenue@gmail.com. Absolutely, you can.
May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless my brother in the deen, alhamdulillah.
Ameen. Everyone, if we can all say ameen for this, inshallah. Anyway, love you all for the sake of Allah, my Muslim brothers and sisters. For anyone who's been watching this video and you've not accepted Islam, please take heed to what our wonderful brother here has given a message of. And inshallah, know that Islam is not terror, Islam is peace. And this is what the word salam means. Jesus, peace be upon him, also used to say this. And this is how he used to greet the people. So peace to you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.